Hello and welcome to Newsclick. The prospective visit of the Indian Prime Minister Manmohan Singh to a meeting of the heads of governments of the Commonwealth in Sri Lanka has created a controversy. The Tamil Nadu State Assembly has recently passed a resolution that has clearly said that the Prime Minister should not visit Sri Lanka in light of the angst and anger in Tamil Nadu at the brutal civil war that took place 4 years ago. Today we have with us Ahilan Kadirgamar, a member of the Collective for Economic Democratisation and a researcher who is based in Jaffna. And we shall ask him as to what expectations that the ordinary Sri Lankan Tamil has in Sri Lanka vis-a-vis this issue. Ahilan, welcome to Newsclick.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, before I asking you about this present issue, there is a recent elections in to the provincial council in the north in Sri Lanka after a very long time. And the Tamil National Alliance was elected overwhelmingly. While this is a positive development in the sense that the mandate of the Tamil people is pretty clear, this doesn't mean that the challenges for the TNA are not quite there. They have humongous challenges. Could you elaborate on the challenges that they face vis-a-vis the issue of devolution of powers, vis-a-vis what they would do considering they are in some sense isolated in the larger Sri Lankan polity?
That's right. This recent election has created an important opening. I would say perhaps the biggest opening since the end of the war with respect to the Northern Province. And while the TNA has got an overwhelming mandate, now they have 30 of the 38 seats in the Northern Provincial Council, there are many challenges. The first challenge is to for the last 4.5 years, and even during the war, the administration in the north has been militarized. We could even say, in many ways, it has been a military administration. The governor for the northern province, for example, continues to be a former military general. So is, for example, even the government agent for the Mennar district. So one major challenge, and I think the TNA is conscious of this, is to transform this military administration into a civil administration, right. A civil administration under the Northern Provincial Council, right. Led by Chief Minister Vikneswaran. Right. So that hopefully will also begin a process of demilitarization. Right. The military presence in the north should be reduced. The military should go back to the barracks. Right. Right. Now, related to that, there has been much debate about what are called police and land powers under the 13th Amendment to our Constitution, which defines the powers of the provincial councils.
Right.
Now, the question of whether there will be a local police force, right. And to what extent the provincial council will be able to alienate land and control of land. And this comes in the context of larger concerns about the military acquiring land in the north.
Right, right.
But while this has been extensively debated, mm-hmm. I think the real challenge is in terms of the role that the Northern Provincial Council can play, mm-hmm. on the economic front, mm-hmm. both in terms of day-to-day economic needs.
Mm-hmm.
Now, it has been 4.5 years since the end of the war, mm-hmm. but very little in the form of economic development that really helps the people. There has been infrastructure that has been built.
Right.
Large roads have been built.
Right.
And to the credit of the government, they have also electrified parts of the rural north, which is right. significant.
Right.
And the Indian government is also contributing 50,000 houses, mainly to the north, but also to some other regions, including the east,
right.
and I believe the upcountry. Where plantation Tamils live.
Right.
But while these initiatives are going forward, what we see in the countryside in the north now is huge amount of indebtedness.
Right.
In other words, over the last few years, the local economy has been running on debt.
Mm.
Livelihoods have really not picked up.
Mm.
Agriculture has been disrupted, unfortunately also by bad rains over the last 2 years. So agricultural incomes remain low. The fisheries, agriculture and fisheries are the two major livelihood creation sectors.
Mm-hmm.
Fisheries has also been disrupted, and this is mainly the main cause of this. Indian trawlers from Tamil Nadu poaching the northern seas. So these are issues that have to be addressed. And the real need now is steady incomes. In other words, some kind of employment where people get steady income. So there is need for investment. And these are the major challenges, the economic challenges, and what role can the Northern Provincial Council play in this context? Now, if you look at the budgetary allocations, the actual budgetary allocations for most provincial councils is very minimal. Now, in Sri Lankan rupees, our GDP is something like 75 billion Sri Lankan rupees. But you know, the allocation for the entire budget is somewhere on the order of 1.5 billion rupees. But for the northern, 1.5 trillion rupees. And for the northern province, recurrent and capital expenditure put together is only 18 billion rupees. So, and much of that would be used for the salaries of provincial staff, whether it's teachers or nurses and so on. So in terms of capital expenditure, the Northern Provincial Council will have very little, even though there's a huge need in terms of investment and development. So that would, but the role that the Northern Provincial Council can play in this context is to work with the center and try and get international development projects for the north. Now that would have to be agreement signed between the central government and the international actors, but the Northern Provincial Council can play a facilitation role. They can continue to engage the central government on the on the priorities. So as I mentioned, the priorities have been large-scale infrastructure, which does little for the rural population. And much of the north is the rural population. So on the economic front, there's much that the Northern Provincial Council needs to do.
So you are telling me that the immediate necessity or the immediate priority are in the northern province relate to that of ameliorating livelihoods. That's the immediate priority. But unfortunately, or rather, but in India, the general opinion is that the Sri Lankan government should be taken to task for what it did during the brutal phase of the civil war in 2009. And that has driven the angst and anger in the neighboring province of Tamil Nadu. And that has perhaps also put pressure on the political parties to come up with this resolution, which calls for a boycott of the Commonwealth summit there. Do you think this is in line with what the ordinary Sri Lankan Tamil would want?
Now, I cannot represent the entire perspective of the local population here. And like in any place, there are varied lines or varied thinking on what the response of the international actors should be. What I can say, and I think there is a sizable section of the population who also shares this, is that first, obviously, there has to be some accounting for what happened at the end of the war. You know, in a brutal war like that, many people have disappeared, many people were killed, and there has to be an accounting of what happened to them. That's important for the local people. If people have lost loved ones, they would want to know what happened, who was responsible, and so forth. And even the government's own Lessons Learned and Reconciliation Commission, its report 2 years ago was very forthright in saying that there has to be some accounting. So that is indeed an important concern. At the same time, as I mentioned, it has been 4.5 years since the war. And in parts of the Vanni where some of the most brutal fighting took place and destruction, now we are facing a situation where in some families they are only eating one meal a day. The economic situation has become quite dire, and we are looking at malnutrition and even starvation if something is not done immediately about the kind of mounting economic crisis. And in the long term also, we don't see much of a future. So in this context, my concern is that internationally, whether it's in Tamil Nadu or with the Tamil diaspora, what has become dominant is a politics of boycott. But in other words, all they call for is a boycott of Sri Lanka and some sanction. I think it is necessary, and there needs to be engagement in international forums such as the UN Human Rights Council or the General Assembly on the situation in Sri Lanka, including the past.
Right.
But that should be a politics of engagement
right.
that attempts to make a difference on the ground.
Right.
And so I would put these two forms of politics in tension, a politics of boycott versus a politics of engagement.
Mm-hmm.
Because what we saw was that even in August this year, prior to the Northern Provincial Council elections, when the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights visited the North and East, that is High Commissioner Navi Pillay, that opened up some space, that emboldened
right.
the local population.
Right.
Similarly, you know, in holding the Commonwealth Conference,
right.
the pressure that was mounted on the government was what led to the holding of the Northern Provincial Council election.
Right.
That has also created
right.
an opening.
Right.
Now, this is what I call a politics of engagement.
Right.
It doesn't mean that we compromise our principles.
Okay.
We have to stick to our principles. And,
right.
and there, as I mentioned earlier, the question of accountability is important.
Right.
At the same time, the question of the economic situation facing the local population and a long-term political settlement is also important.
Right.
So, and how do we engage the government at the center? How do we change the direction in the country, which has become more and more polarized even since the end of the
right.
war,
right. Right.
so that there are concrete changes on the ground?
Right.
And for that, I believe, you know, more actors from India, you know, whether it's the Prime Minister or the Foreign Minister,
mm-hmm.
whether it's a delegation of members of Parliament, whether it's Indian intellectuals,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Artists,
mm-hmm.
them visiting the North will open up space here.
So,
and I would say the same about also progressive intellectuals, actors from southern Sri Lanka, from the Sinhala community also visiting
right.
The North, will open up the space here
yeah.
for others to take up this transformation that's necessary, as I mentioned earlier,
right.
from a militarized situation
right.
to a situation where there's a civil administration
so you're,
and demilitarization.
Yeah. So you're saying that you would not only welcome the Indian Prime Minister to visit the heads of government summit, but also you should visit the northern province and get a perspective on what the people of there want.
That's correct, and hopefully his visit would lead to further forms of support to the population here. As I mentioned, you know, one of the largest projects in the north, and it benefits people. You know, people many of whose houses were destroyed,
right.
many of them who only lived in mud huts, but for the first time they had the opportunity to build a concrete house.
Right.
It's this Indian housing scheme,
right.
50,000 houses, which is significant. You know,
right.
The population of the North is 1 million.
Okay.
And given that the, for a population like that,
mm-hmm.
50,000 houses is significant. You know, as I mentioned, if
right.
If we do a simple calculation, 50,000 houses at 550,000
right.
rupees each
right.
is the equivalent of
right.
27.5 billion
right.
rupees.
Right. Right.
So, you know, if you compare that even to the Northern Provincial Council budget I mentioned earlier of 17.2 billion, it's significant.
Right.
So, I think those kinds of support are important. And the reality is that, you know, while there have been a number of Western governments who have been very vocal on the concern issues
mm-hmm.
in the North,
mm-hmm.
when it comes to actual development aid,
mm-hmm.
It has been minimal. This is partly because of the economic crisis after 2008, and Sri Lanka is no longer seen as a conflict country. So
mm-hmm.
I think India's engagement in particular in this context would be important if this war torn
mm-hmm.
population is to mm-hmm. move forward.
Ahilan, another festering issue that, you know, exercises the government of Tamil Nadu in particular, and also the opposition there, is the very regular arrests of fishermen that come from Tamil Nadu and who go in the trawlers to fish in the waters of Sri Lanka. Is there a solution that is humanitarian in nature and not necessarily legal in nature that would satisfy both the people of the north in Sri Lanka and as well as the fishermen from Tamil Nadu?
Now this trawling is banned in Sri Lanka for very good reasons.
Right.
Because, as you know, bottom trawling is extremely environmentally destructive.
Right.
It drags the bottom of the ocean.
Right.
And it's not sustainable. Then the fish stock continues to decrease.
Right. Right. Right.
So I think there needs to be a solution that is found. That, you know, on the one hand, now increasingly, you know, the fishing community in northern Sri Lanka, many of them are having to even give up their way of life. Some of them have to even do mason work and so on, because on the 3 days that Indian trawlers come to Sri Lanka, because there's an agreement between small fishermen and mechanized boats in India after a major conflict there, that trawlers only will come out on 3 days, on Saturday, Monday, and Wednesday nights. On those days, our fishermen do not even go to sea. So automatically, almost half their fishing days have been decreased. And also the catch has become smaller because of this destructive form of trawling. Now, given the kind of difficulties that the northern fishing community faced during the war, they were not allowed to go to sea. They were already economically devastated. So in that context, you know, many fishermen say that have come to the position in the north that, you know, the maritime boundary is important, that Indian, not only trawlers, but even other fishermen should not come this side, because they see a direct relationship to their fallen livelihoods. But as you mentioned, there needs to be some kind of a solution to this problem. What I think many analysts on the India side have also advocated is that perhaps there needs to be some kind of a buyback scheme by the central government or the Tamil Nadu government so that it decommissions these trawlers, which is a very destructive fishing practice, and maybe they are, you know, they change to deep sea fishing. Similarly, you know, while this is the most immediate and urgent issue for the fishermen in the north, there also needs to be some amount of investment in the fishing sector in the north. You know, now many of the fishermen tell me that back in the early 80s, something like 30% of fish production in Sri Lanka came from Jaffna, which was a major mainstay, and there was quite a bit of capital accumulation. But now that number is much, much smaller. So there needs to be refrigeration facilities, harbors have to be developed, and this kind of assistance also is necessary. And instead of this, you know, this conflict between the Indian fishermen and the northern Sri Lankan northern fishermen, this is becoming a major conflict. Now, there's a lot of anger in Jaffna and the north about Indian trawling, which can put a wedge between relations between the Sri Lankan Tamil population and Tamil Nadu. So it's in the interest of also the Tamil Nadu government to solve this issue. Now, I think many of us have also taken the position that in no way should violence be used against these Indian fishermen, even if they cross the border. And hopefully that message is also clear to the Sri Lankan Navy. But there have been arrests. And more recently, what has happened is that the Sri Lankan government has taken the position that the fishermen will be released. Now, some of them have lagged on much longer than we would like to see. But that maybe the trawlers will be confiscated. This is a new strategy that the Sri Lankan government seems to be taking, and to be honest, you know, that has some resonance within the northern fish community as well. Now, this is also, you know, on the Sri Lankan side, there are other dynamics. Now, the TNA, which represents the north, has been reluctant to take this issue up, both internationally, because they feel that politically the support from Tamil Nadu and India is important, and there are caste class dynamics within the Sri Lankan north, where the marginalized fishing community's concerns are sidelined in the interest of other political concerns. But I take the view that, you know, this is as political and as important an issue, because in Jaffna there is something like 20,000 families, over over I would say close to 15% of the northern population depends on fishing and the fisheries sector. So this is not something that we can ignore, and a solution to this is important. And I hope that the Indian government will expedite talks. There needs to be talks between the local fishing community here and the fishing community in Tamil Nadu. There were talks in 2010, but neither of the governments then took forward those talks towards an agreement between two governments. So there needs to be talks between the fishing community. There needs to be talks between the governments, the central government in India, the government in Sri Lanka, as well as perhaps now the Northern Provincial Council chief minister, as well as the Tamil Nadu government, can be involved in these talks to arrive at a solution soon.
Thanks, Ahilan.
Thank you.